Hello my friends and welcome back to another episode of Flutter Explained. Today we want to talk about WebRTC in Flutter and Dart. We first want to have a look on what WebRTC is, web peer-to-peer connection over the internet to get your video and audio streams. And also after that we want to have a deep dive on how we implement that step by step. For that we will use a Turn server of Google and a signaling server with Firebase. There you have the full control and can see how the things are working, and I hope you enjoyed the episode. So now let's get started. Today's episode gets sponsored by GetStream.io, a fantastic toolkit for Flutter and Dart where you can create a fantastic chat messaging app in no time and also activity feeds. It is allowed to have it in multiple platforms, but thanks to Flutter, you can use it everywhere you want. Also, that's fantastic. Robert Brunhagen already created a video on how to integrate this chat messenger in your application. So feel free to check that out. And now let's go further with the video. All right, so WebRTC is there to create a real-time communication application. That means you can create one or multiple peers and they want to communicate in video and audio format. That is possible via the protocol, open source protocol of WebRTC. Big companies like, for example, Google, Mozilla, Microsoft and Apple supports this standard, and that's why it is so powerful. So it allows you to create such applications not only in the browser but also natively today. Okay, but how does that actually work? We have one peer or one client and another client, and they want now to communicate. So we have these two clients, and now we need something called a signaling server and a turn server. The turn server allows you to really transfer the communication of the video. And don't worry, there are a lot of free options that you can use from Google, for example. But also, if you want to host your own, you can do that with Coturn project, for example, that allows you even a Docker image that is officially released that you can just pass up and try to connect with it. On the other side, we have the signaling server. The signaling server is like a contract between the two clients, because what you need to understand is that clients usually don't live in the same local environment. That being said, is that these two clients usually live behind firewalls and also change their IP addresses frequently because of the NAT. That allows not really an easy connection between two peers, right? They really try to connect, but there is still something in between. But there is a solution for that, and thanks to WebRTC, we have that. It's called the ICE protocol. So the ICE protocol, or Interactivity Connectivity Establishment, allows now the clients to share their information about how to connect with them. That means the one who offered something will now tell every other client how they can connect with him, and also on the other side, they will allow him to give him information on how he can connect to them. With that, you have now all the possibilities so that the signal server don't really know about the media itself. That happens through the turn server. But the turn server can now connect via these information. And that's pretty awesome, because now the clients can connect as much as they want in real time. But now we have made a lot of theory, right? Now we want to get deep, dig inside of the code, and let's have a look on how we can implement all that stuff without having any troubles. For that, we will create rooms. And inside of each of these rooms, we will make the handshake between the STP, the ICE, and at the end, the connection between the two, and show the video. All right, so let's begin this session by explaining you what we want to achieve. On the left side, you see now our Chrome browser, and on the right side, our Mozilla browser, two completely separated clients. And if I press on open camera and microphone, you will see finally myself, hey. And on the right side, we activate also the camera and choose a different camera. This is the one from my laptop now, hey there. And with both, you can see me now, right? Now we create on one of the clients a room. This room is a unique identifier that I can copy over to the other client. And if I press now join the room, you will see now both images here, and as I move myself along with both cameras. So that means both of them have now a real connection. If you think about now, hey, why can't I hear the voice here and why I can't hear the audio? I deactivated that for this example, but we will make it possible that you have it inside of it. So, but how does it look in our Firebase actually? Let's take that over and look into our Firex store. If I reload that really quickly, you can see we created rooms, and in one of these rooms, I guess this is the one, we find this SDP, the Session Description Protocol. And inside of that, we also have two different collections, and these different collections are our ICE protocols. So here you find the candidates with all the possible ways on how we can connect with the clients. And we have one from the callee and one from the caller. The caller is the one who created the room. The callee is the one who wants to talk with the room. And with that, we have created our peer-to-peer connection. But now let's head over to the tutorial and see how it is actually done. All right, so as you already guessed, this is a bit more complicated. So for that, we have already some boilerplate. For example, in the main.dart, we have the app already completely created with all the different smarts. As you can see, I created already a signaling. Here inside, we have all the toolings that we need and where we actually will work in this tutorial. So there you will find all the interesting parts. Then we have a local and remote renderer. This comes from the Flutter WebRTC package, which allows us to show the different images, or better, the video streams. Then we have a room ID. The room ID will be filled with the room ID that I tell you. And we have a text editing layer where we have the room ID to enter, right? That we can connect to it. Then in the init state, we have to initialize the local and remote stream. And we have the on-add remote stream. This happens on the signaling and is a stream. Don't worry about it. Whenever there happens a new stream from the remote, we will access that one and put it inside of the remote renderer, which then will show us the images. I just put here a set state. I'm pretty sure we don't even need it, but I just wanted to make sure. Then we have the dispose. Don't forget that we have to dispose the local and remote renderer, else you will maybe have some weird conditions and also some memory leaks. Then inside of the build, we just create a scaffold and columns where we have the different buttons inside. And as you can see, all these buttons call at the end the signaling part. So we have already created some different methods here, like open user media, create room, join room, and so on and so forth, and pass different things inside. Also here we find the expanded, where we have the two video streams inside, and one of them is mirrored. What does that mean? It switches the image for you so that you have the feeling that you look into the right direction. Sounds weird, but it makes sense. So just the web stream is just mirrored. That's everything for that part. And we have the part where we have the text editing controller. If we now jump inside of the signaling service that I called talked about already, I have prepared some things. For example, we prepared the configuration for the ICE servers. As I said, they can be used for free, and they are from Google in that case. I will put down in the video description a link to a GitHub repository where a lot of these different free Stun servers are in part of it. Now here you can see we already created a so-called peer connection, which is very important for the WebRTC part. Then we have the video streams, local and remote. We have a room ID, the current room text. This is just the text that we got from the front end. And on at remote stream, this is the stream state callback that I told you about. Okay. Then we have the create room, and inside of here we have already the Firebase connection done. We have the room definition. I added everywhere a lot of prints so that you can follow up what exactly happens below. Then we create a peer connection. That is a very important step because this one will allow us to create the connection to a different peer. After that, we register peer connection listeners. This is a helper method that I created and set up for you that whenever there happens a state change inside of the peer connection, we print that actually. So if we gather the ICE connections, we do it here. If we have a different connection state, we show here a print message and so on and so forth. The only exception here is the on at stream. So whenever the peer connection receives a new stream, we will print that one and we call the on-add remote stream call so that we update the remote stream here. And that's absolutely for that part. Good. So now we have that and we have here this get tracks. So when we have a local stream and we have like let's say it like video and audio information, we will add here the streams for each track that we receive. A track is nothing else like a stream from the video or audio file. Okay, then we have another listener created on track. So whenever there happens that the peer connection receives a new track, then you will get the print here. And if we receive the first track here, we make a for each on them and adding them to the remote stream. And last but not least, we will return the room ID, but this we will do together. As you can see here, we have the to-dos. They are separated in four to-dos that we have to do in order to create a room. The first thing is what we have to do is collecting our local ICE candidates. So from our current local, we need to get all the possible connection possibilities and need to store them in Firebase. After that, we need some code to create a room. Then we will listen to remote session descriptions so that someone accepted our offer and we can exchange our ICE protocols. After that, we want to listen for remote ICE candidates below. So this happens that we want to get the connection possibilities from the other side. And as I said, last but not least, we will return the room ID. If we join a room, so that means someone else created the room, now we want to join him, we will do the same thing but the opposite way. We first get some room snapshots, we check if the room is existent, we have added the peer connection listeners again, and after that, here you can see the to-do, we are collecting again the ICE candidates, but this time from the local of the second client, right, the one that wants to join. After that, we create our SDP, our session description protocol, as an answer and send that to Firebase. And last but not least, we listen for remote ICE candidates. And this allows us to join a room. That's it already. And all the other stuff like the open user media is also very important because here we call the stream and the navigator media devices get user media. With that, we get the allowance from the browser or from the different apps or macOS if we are allowed to access video and audio streams. And with this call, we get the allowance or we don't get it and get rejected, but usually we should get it. And then we have the possibility to override the source object of the local video and the source object of the remote video. This is now just a basic stream that we create locally because in this position where we call this open user media, we don't actually have a stream for that. And last but not least, we have the hangup. And nothing else what we are doing here is more the opposite of creating a WebRTC. We're getting all the tracks, we're stopping all the tracks, we're looking for remote streams, we close all the remote streams, all the peer connections getting closed. If we don't have a if we have a room ID, we remove also the room reference at the end and we dispose our local and remote stream. Cool. So that's the boilerplate. So you see already that was quite a lot and it is really not an easy topic. So that's why I focus on these critical things like collecting the ICE candidates, add the code for creating a room and listening for remote session and the remote ICE candidates. So without further ado, let's get started finally. So first things first, what we have to do to create and collect our own ICE candidates. We first call the caller candidates collections on the Firebase in order to have access to it. The next step would be to call the onICE candidate possibility of the peer connection, which calculates all the different candidates that we have locally. For each candidate that we find, we print the candidate to a map. And in this map, as you can see inside, we find the candidate, SDP mid and SDP mid lane index. And as you can see, now we put them into this caller candidates collection.add. That means from now on, they are saved in the Firebase. Perfect. With that, we have already collected our local ICE candidates. So because we create the room, we create also the offer in the peer connection. With that, we finally create our ICE candidates. So this one getting triggered by this call. And now what we want to do is creating the session description protocol. But luckily, the Flutter WebRTC package already offers us a possibility called set local description with the offer. And now we created this local description for us. But in order to create that local SDP information, we would need to write a lot of things. But luckily, we have a package for that, right? So set local description offer description with the offer will create us the local description protocol that we need in order to create an offer for Firebase. So the next step is to create a room with offer. where we have the offer that is the map of the offer. If we look inside of it, you can see we have this session description protocol and a type. So it could be media, it could be video and stuff like that. And now with this offer, we just use the room ref, which is the collection, if you remember, and set the room with the offer. After that, we take this room ref ID, which we get from Firebase, automatically created as our room ID. By the way, about the whole real-time communication part, don't forget to hit the like button, subscribe to our channel if you haven't yet, and thanks once more to our fantastic sponsors of GetStream.io. All right, so that's it. We have created already the room, so we can get that away. We have the room with offer, room reference set with this room offer, and we created the room ID that we need. Now we head over to listening for remote session description below. So that means we have created our SDP and send it to Firebase. Now we want to listen to the change that happens on Firebase on the remote side. So the first thing that we have to do is to listen to the room reference if there is some new snapshot coming in. And we listen to that, and now inside of that we get the information if something has changed in the room ref. So this part is getting a bit more complicated. Let's have a look. So first we get the data as a JSON here again, because snapshot.data is just returning us as JSON. After that I make a check if the peer connection get remote description is not null. And the data answer is also not null, because we need the answer from the colleague. If we check now, we create then an RTC session description, and this RTC session description has the answer of the SDP and the data of the type, nothing else. And this is our answer. And as you can see now, in the peer connection set remote description, we pass into now the answer. That means the peer connection knows now about the local description and the remote description. And together we have now our connection created. All right, so now we got the offer and the answer, but now we have to get the ICE candidates to allow the connection between the two clients. So how do we do that? So what we do is we go to the room ref collection callee candidates. So from the remote, the callee is the remote one, and check for the snapshots and we listen for them, right? So if something changes, we get notified. So if we take a look on what happens next, there is happening actually quite a lot. So we check the snapshot if the document has changed. So if there is anything new happened, and this change, we check if the type of this change is document change type edit. So that is all Firebase related, right? So document change type edit doesn't just save us if there has been a new edit document. Then we do the same thing as above. We get again a JSON with data from the document. I make some print statement here. And then we see that the peer connection get a new candidate. And this new candidate is like a new remote guy who wants to talk with us. So we have the candidate, the SDP mid, and the M-line index. All things that it needs to connect. And that's actually it for creating the room. As you can see, the only thing that I should do is also returning the room ID from above. Cool. So with that, we created already our room. Let's have a look how it looks in the web. All right, so I started the application here and I can click on open camera and microphone. As you can see, I already allowed it for this browser to access my camera, but else you would get the pop-up where you have to say allow. Now we can create our room. And as you can see, we have joined following a room. We get our ID already. If we take now a look into Firebase once more, what we can see here is the following. We get now our collection rooms, and I deleted all the other ones to just check for you how it looks. So we have the room ID. This is the one that we received. If you take a look here, we see that this is the same ID. And on the right side, we find the SDP with all the informations of the offer. You can see that here, offer. And inside of that, this is the one who gets all the information about how we can talk with the room. Then we have the caller candidates. These are the ICE candidates for this remote local at the moment. So if we check here inside, we have this candidate with some connection information, and all of them are possibilities to access the client. Because phone calls are pretty boring if you are alone, the next step would be to how to join a room, right? So what we did at the beginning, if you remember, we have called the room ref get to get the correct room ID document. And if the room exists, then we want to try to connect. We create again a peer connection, we register for the listeners, we have the local stream that we have set up. And now what we want to do is collecting the ICE candidates, but this time from the remote one. because not both can create a room and not both can join, now we want to create the ICE candidates for the local for the second one. So let's see how we do that. So this time, instead of the caller reference, we need the callee candidates collection that is inside of the room ref callee candidates. If we scroll up now on how to check how we did get the ICE candidates on top, we can do exactly the same thing for this client, right? That means we can just copy that part down here and we have to reference the right collection. And that's actually it to get the collection of the ICE candidates. Next step, code for creating the STP answers below. Let's get into it. Okay, so code for creating the STP answer. Let us think about it. So now the offer is already created. We have access to the room and now we want to send our STP information. For that, we first get the offerings STP and create out of that our own. So let's copy that inside and let's have a look. So first we get the data again as a JSON. We put that in an offer from the data. After that, we create inside of our peer connection the remote description because we know already the information about STP and type here. After that, we get an answer that we create inside of the peer connection because the peer connection says, okay, I have already an RTC session description that we can use to create the answer. And after that, it says, okay, the peer connection sets the local description with this answer. And as we did before, we get now room with answers, and this room with answer we save up in the room reference. With that, we have now saved the type and STP of the answer. So if we would see that in a later inside of Firebase, we can see that the room now contains not only an offer, but also the answer STP. So, and the last step is actually pretty easy again. If we scroll up here, we can see that we got the collection of the callee candidate to get the ICE candidates. And this time we just want to do exactly the opposite. So we just copy the whole text and stuff and putting it down here. And instead of having callee, this time we wait for the caller. Let me get the right... Perfect. And with that, we are finished here. We can remove the last to-dos and actually try it out if the remote works. All right, so now I created in debug mode, both on the Chrome session. Don't worry, it's now the same camera that you will see. So if I open up the camera here, it will ask me if I should allow it and I will open it here. And now we create a room on the left side. We get our ID. We join the room on the right side. And you will see the same camera position. One of them is mirrored, the other one not. So that's why it looks so weird. Oh, yeah, look at that. Cool things. Sorry. Okay, cool thing. So now we have created the remote connection. Both are working happily fine and I'm pretty happy with this result. So let's have another look into Firebase. How does it look here? So we can see we have created the room, as I told you. We have the room identifier, we have the answer, and we have the offer here inside, both with the STP connection. We have the callee and the caller information about the ICE service inside of a separate collection. And that's absolutely it with RepRTC. Two things that I want to mention regarding to downsides at the moment. I didn't get it to run in macOS and iOS, sadly, because of the higher versions. I'm working on an M1 chip at the moment, and I think that makes some troubles. Also on my phone, I have an iOS 14.5 or something, so the RepRTC package has been some troubles. I didn't have an Android testing device to check it out, so sorry that I couldn't give you more. Also, what I want to announce is that the Flutter WebRTC don't have any documentation at the moment, so you can only find an example application and an example server that you have to manage yourself. So it is quite a complicated topic at the end, but if you have some time to invest inside of it, feel free to create some issues and document it. All right, so now you should be able to create your own WebRTC clients to create real-time communication via different peer-to-peer connections. That is pretty amazing. You have that now on Flutter, which means you have it basically on every different platform. And with that, you have the possibility to really take the last advantage out of WebRTC. I cannot wait to see what you have created. Please let me know down in the comments below. And besides of that, there is nothing else to say then. hit the like button if you haven't yet, subscribe to our channel, and thanks once more to our sponsors GetStream.io. See ya, until the next time, your Max. Bye.